So first, I'd like to thank the organizers of PPDP and LOPSTR for this kind invitation. Okay. So today, I'm going to talk about our high-order model checking project at the University of Tokyo. Is mic on? Okay. So this project has started about 10 years ago following these two papers, one of which has been presented at PPDP, just introduced. Okay. So that's why I chose this as a topic of this invited talk. And these two papers have been later combined to this JSIM article. So before going into details, let me just give you a very quick demonstration of the tool we have developed in the project. So that is called Mochi, which is a kind of software model checker for OCaml. Okay? So here is a web interface of our tool, Mochi. And this is a sample input, which is just an OCaml program. Okay? So this part defines recursive function named MC91. So it just implements MacRC's 91 function. And this main function asserts its property that if the input n is no greater than 101, then the result should be always 91. And the goal of verification here is to check that this assertion never fails for any integer input n, including negative integers. And here, we consider unbounded integers instead of 32 or 64-bit integers. So there are infinitely many possible inputs. And we still want to prove that this assertion never fails for any possible input. Okay? So to check that property, we just need to push this button. Okay? And then the system automatically analyzes it and says that the program is safe. So this means that this assertion never fails. Okay? And if we change the program a bit, for example, if we insert equality here, okay, so then the system now says that the program is unsafe. And it says that assertion failure indeed occurs when input n is 100. Okay? So here is another example that uses high-order functions, lists, and exceptions. Okay? So this main function first creates a list consisting of n integers, and then use fold list function to divide n by all the elements in the list. Okay? So then, so here we want to check that there is no division by zero exception. Okay? And this program is indeed safe, because if we look at the definition of makeList function, which is defined here, okay, so then we can see that each element is created by this randPos function. Okay? And if we look at the definition of randPos function, we can see that only positive integer is returned. Okay? So there can be no division by zero exception. And our tool can make such kind of reasoning fully automatically, and concludes that the program is safe. Okay? And if we change the definition of randPos function so that zero may be returned, okay, so then the system now says that the program is unsafe, and it shows a concrete execution sequence that leads to uncaught exception. So we have constructed this kind of tool based on high-order model checking. Okay? Sorry. Okay, so here is a plan of the talk. So I'll first explain what is high-order model checking, and then I'll explain what we have been doing in the project following the timeline. And I hope that this part also serves as a gentle introduction to foundations and theory, foundations and applications of high-order model checking, okay? So what is high-order model checking? So as many of you probably know, finite state model checking aims to check whether a given finite state system satisfies a property described by certain temporal logic, like multi-mute calculus, or subclasses of it, like LTL or CTL. And there are two kinds of high-order extensions of that in the literature. So one is host model checking, where the systems to be verified have been extended to high-order ones called high-order recursion schemes. So these are kinds of high-order tree grammars that are useful for modeling a certain class of infinite state systems, such as high-order functional programs. And there's another notion of high-order model checking, where the logic has been extended to high-order one called high-order fixed-point logic. And this is useful for describing non-regular properties of systems that cannot be expressed by the model calculus. Okay? So we have been working on both kinds of high-order model checking, but for now, let us focus on this host model checking. So this is obtained by extending models to high-order recursion schemes. So what are they? So high-order recursion scheme is a kind of tree grammar for generating a single, possibly infinite tree. Okay. So this is an example of order zero host, which consists of two rules for rewriting trees. Okay. So these terms should be interpreted as these trees. In other words, small letters represent tree constructors. Okay? So given the start symbol S, okay, we can rewrite it to ACB by using the first rule. Okay? And by using the second rule, we can rewrite B and obtain this. Okay? Then we can further rewrite S. Okay? And by repeating these steps, we get this infinite tree as a sort of the limit of infinite rewritings. Okay? And in higher order recursion schemes, each non-terminal can take parameters. Okay? And there is a notion of orders. And in order one, parameters must be trees. But in order two, they can be functions on trees. In order three, parameters can be functions on trees, like that. Okay? And there are important restrictions here. So each non-terminal has its own type. And rewriting rules must respect that. Okay? And there are no pattern matching rules, okay? Unlike time rewriting systems. So these are important to ensure that model checking problem is decidable. Okay? So anyway, this is an example of order one host where non-terminal A takes a tree X as a parameter. Okay? So given the start symbol S, we can rewrite it to A of C. Okay? Then we can rewrite A with the second rule to get this one. Okay? So here, this X has been instantiated to C. Okay? And then we can further rewrite A and get this. And by repeating these steps, we get this infinite tree. Okay? So if you are familiar with functional programs, you can think of host just as a simply typed functional program just for generating a single, possibly infinite tree. Okay? And host model checking is a following problem. So given a host G for describing a tree, and a formula phi for describing a tree property, okay? So we can instead use a tree automata, alternatively. Then we are interested in checking whether the tree generated by G satisfies phi. Okay? And by using tree automata or multi-mean calculus, we can, for example, ask whether every finite path ends with C or whether A occurs below B, like that. Okay? So for the previous example, the answer to the first question is yes, right? And the answer to the second question is, okay, no, right? So A cannot occur below B, okay? So Ong has proved that, Ong has proved that this problem is decidable and that this is Kx time complete, okay? So although the problem is decidable, it is highly intractable from complexity theoretic point of view. Okay? But please do not worry too much about that point, because as I explain later, there are actually practical algorithms that do not always suffer from this worst case behavior. Okay, so those those who are familiar with ordinary notions of model checking may have thought that this host model checking as a rather exotic notion of model checking, because host model checking talks about infinite trees, whereas ordinary model checking talks about transition systems, right? But given this kind of infinite tree, if we fold this equivalent nodes, okay, then we get this transition system. Okay, and conversely, if we unfold this back edge, then we obtain this kind of infinite tree. Okay. So then the question on infinite trees, like whether A occurs below B, can be turned into a question on transition systems of whether there is a transition sequence in which A occurs after B. So through this correspondence, high-order model checking can be considered a generalization of ordinary notions of model checking. Okay? And in fact, the trees generated by order zero hosts are always regular. That corresponds to finite state transition systems. And in order one, we can express more complex trees that correspond to transition systems generated by pushdown systems. So in that sense, order zero host model checking corresponds to finite state model checking, and order one corresponds to pushdown model checking, and we can go up to arbitrary orders to deal with more complex systems. Okay. So that is a quick introduction to high order model checking. And any questions so far? Okay, so now let me move on to explain how we got started the project. Okay, so I attended two talks by Ong about host model checking twice. Okay. So once at IFIP working group meeting, and the second time at FOSAX 2008. And so when I listened to his talk for the first time, I thought that it is theoretically interesting, but I had no idea about how that can be applied to practical problems. And when I listened to the second time, I started to think about how we can apply it to program verification, because I was in general interested in program verification. But I still had no concrete idea about how it can be applied to program verification. But what I was lucky was that at that time, I was also working with Atsushi Igarashi from Kyoto University on a program verification problem, which we called resource usage analysis. So it is this kind of problem. So given this kind of file accessing program, we are interested in statically checking whether the program accesses files in a valid manner. Or more generally, given a program that accesses various resources like files, logs, or network objects, we are interested in statically checking whether the program conforms to a certain protocol, valid resource access protocol. So by the way, let me explain this program because I'll use this as a kind of running example. Okay? So this part defines recursive function f, which takes a file pointer x as an argument. And this is an non-deterministic Boolean value. So it either closes x or read x and recursively calls itself. And it opens file foo and passes file pointer y to f. So this program should be okay. So this uses file foo as a read-only file. And we want to statically check that kind of property. Okay? And in Popper 2002, we have presented a sound but incomplete method for checking this kind of property. And we are looking for a better method for checking this. Okay? And a few months after listening to Hossack's 2008 talk, I suddenly realized that we can use host model checking to solve this kind of problem in a complete manner. Okay. So the idea was as follows. So given this kind of program, we transform this program to a grammar host that generates a tree that represents how the file foo is accessed by this program. Okay. So here, a plus represents non-deterministic choice. Okay. So this tree says that the program either closes a file and terminates, or reads a file and then either closes a file and terminates, or reads a file, etc. Okay. So this tree exactly represents how the file is accessed by this program. So once we get such a grammar, okay, then this program verification problem can be reduced to host model checking problem of whether every path of the tree is labeled by RSRC. Okay? So in this way, program verification problem can be reduced to host model checking in a sound and complete manner. Okay? And actually, this transformation can be performed in a rather systematic manner by using well-known transformation for functional programs. So can you guess what this is? Anyone? No? So this is essentially just a CPS transformation. Okay? So this rule for F corresponds to this recursive definition of F. And we have just added additional parameter K, which is essentially a continuation parameter that expresses how the file foo is accessed after the call to F returns. Okay. So then this non-deterministic choice is expressed by the tree constructor plus. And the then part is expressed by C followed by K because the function returns after the close operation. Okay. And the else part is expressed by R followed by the call to F. Okay? And this grammar indeed generates what we want, like this. Okay? Yeah?
So this is essentially first order, right?
Because you can. This is first order one. Yeah, so in general, if the source programs are high order, then you can have high order recursion schemes. Does that answer your question? So this approach of using program transformation to reduce verification problem to host model checking turned out to be quite robust. So it provides a sound, complete, and fully automatic method for a fairly large class of programs and also for a large class of verification problems. So in short, I would say that for finite data high order programs, so by finite data, I mean data over finite sets like Booleans. Okay? So for finite data high order programs, automated verification comes for free from host model checking. So just apply some program transformation. So by the way, so for infinite data high order programs, we can still apply some abstraction to get a sound but incomplete method. So I was very excited to find out that, but there was a question on whether host model checking is feasible in practice. Okay. And this question is critical because host model checking is KX time complete. Okay. So if there is no reasonable model checking algorithm, this framework would be useless in practice. Okay. So I consulted Ong's paper on the desirability of host model checking. Okay. So the proof was written in a full version consisting of 55 pages, and that was full of game semantics. And at that time, I was not familiar with game semantics at all. But the proof was somehow constructive in the sense that it indeed gives a certain algorithm for solving a model checking problem. But it was of the kind that always suffer from this KX time bottleneck. So this algorithm could not be used. Okay. But I noticed that the key notion used there, that is the notion of variable profiles, reminded me of intersection types. So that has led us to develop type theoretic foundations for host model checking. So what we did was to construct a type system parameterized by an automaton that describes a property to be checked, okay? Such that three of G is accepted by automaton A if and only if G is typeable in that type system. So in this way, this host model checking problem is reduced to type checking or type inference problem. Okay. So let me explain a little more about this. So here, let us focus on a restricted version of host model checking problem, where the properties to be verified are described by trivial tree automata, which is the simplest kind of tree automata for infinite trees. Okay. So let me give you an example. So this trivial tree automaton is a kind of top-down tree automaton. Okay. And the image of a transition function is a sequence of states. And that is because a tree has a branching structure, so that we need to specify the next state for each branch of the tree. So for example, this first rule says that upon reading A at state Q0, the automaton should read the first branch with Q0 and the second branch also with Q0. Okay? And then the automaton just traverses the input tree from top to bottom based on the transition function. Okay? And the input tree is accepted just if the run of the automaton does not get stuck. So for this, there's no complex acceptance conditions like Buffy or parity conditions. Okay. Okay. So for this type of tree automaton, host model checking can be easily reduced to a type checking problem. So the idea was to regard a state of the automaton as a type of trees. For example, a state Q can be considered as a type of trees accepted by the automaton when it is run from state Q. Okay. So then we can naturally think about intersection types. Okay. So Q1 and Q2 is a type of trees accepted from both Q1 and Q2. Okay. And based on this notion of type, okay, host model checking problem of whether tree of G is accepted by A can be rephrased as a type checking problem of whether tree of G has type Q0, which is the initial state of the automaton. Okay. And here, please note that this tree of G may be infinite, so that we cannot actually construct the tree and then type check it. So we cannot do that. So instead, we need to look at this grammar and predict the type of trees generated by the grammar. Okay? But that is exactly the same as what usual type systems for programming languages do, right? So usual type systems predict the type of return values without actually running the program, right? So we just need to do the same thing here. Okay? And the only difference is that usual type systems are expected to be sound, but not necessarily complete. Okay? But here, since we want to solve a decision problem, we want the type system not just to be sound, but also complete. Okay? And for that purpose, we employ intersection types. Okay? So here's a type system for host model checking. And I do not expect you to understand these rules. But just please believe me that this is a rather standard intersection type system, except that the types of tree constructors are determined by automaton. Okay? And this type system turned out to be sound and complete. So tree of G is accepted by A if and only if the start symbol S has type Q0. In other words, there exists a type environment gamma on non-terminal symbols or recursive functions such that S has type Q0, and that gamma is consistent with rewriting rules. Okay? So for each assumption that FK has type tau, the body of FK should have that type. And immediate consequence of that is that we have a straightforward algorithm which runs in time linear in the size of the grammar. Okay? So this is such an algorithm. So what we need to do is just to enumerate all the candidates of the types of non-terminal symbols. Okay? And then just repeatedly filters out invalid typings. Okay? And then we just need to check whether S has type Q0 in the remaining valid type environment. That's it. And so this also suggests that this type environment gamma can be used as a sort of certificate of host model checking, such that once a certificate is given, its validity can be efficiently checked. So in that sense, it has a flavor of NP problems like SAT. And the only difference is that this, the size of this certificate gamma can be extremely large. So it can be k-fold exponentially large in the size of the input. But as long as there is a small certificate, it much behaves like NP problems. So there is some hope that this can be solved efficiently in practice. So here's a summary of our popular paper 10 years ago. Okay. So we have shown that program verification problems can be reduced to host model checking. And to solve that, we have developed type-based characterization. And that yielded a fixed parameter linear time algorithm. Okay. But it still remained open whether host model checking is feasible in practice, because this naive algorithm suffers from a huge constant factor. Okay. So that has led us to our work in PPDP 10 years ago, to where we developed a practical algorithm for host model checking. So here was a naive algorithm. And the problem of it was that this gamma max is too large. Okay? So it can be k-fold exponentially large in the size of the input. And the algorithm we presented at PPDP was like this. Okay. So instead of using this gamma max, we first make some guess on the possible types of non-terminals. And then we just need to do the same thing. We filter out invalid typing and whether S has type Q0. And if the guess was wrong, then we go back to the loop and we make another guess. Okay? And we just repeat until we prove or disprove the property. Okay? So the question is, of course, how we can guess the types of non-terminal symbols. And the important observation was that, in general, the type of a function in a program describes how that function will be used in the program, right? So if a function has type int to int, that means if we pass integer to that function, then we get back an integer, okay? So that means we can actually guess the types of function by actually executing the program and observing how that function is used. Okay. So let me explain this with a concrete example of host model checking. So these are examples of host and automaton that I've shown earlier. Okay. And then we reduce the start symbol some finite number of steps. And actually, in this case, just 3 steps. Okay. Then we assign automaton state to each node of the partially created tree and see how these S and F are used in the partial reduction sequence. So let us now focus on this S. Okay? Then clearly, this S is expected to return a tree of type Q0, right? So we put this as a candidate of the type of S. Okay? Now let us focus on this. Okay? So again, this F is expected to return a tree of type Q0. Okay? So the type of S should be of this 4. Okay? Then how can we guess the argument types? For that, we just need to check how the actual argument C is used in this reduction sequence. Okay? So then we can see that this C is used as Q0 here, and also as Q1 here. Okay? So that we can infer that that type of F should be this one. Okay? And we do the same thing for other occurrences of F, and we collect other candidates like this. Okay? So this is our guess for the types of non-terminal symbols. Then we filter out invalid typings. So actually these two are invalid ones, and we are left with these two. And since S has type Q0, okay, so we are done. So we know that the tree generated by this horse is accepted by this automaton. That's it. So based on this idea, we have implemented a higher horse model checker, T-Rex, which is a first model checker, first horse model checker ever implemented. And this does not immediately suffer from KX time bottleneck. And this has been successfully used as a backend of the software model checker Mochi, which I have demonstrated at the beginning. So here's a summary of the results we have obtained in 2009. Okay? So we have shown that horse model checking can be used, applied to program verification. And we have developed type theoretical foundations for that horse model checking. And then based on that, we have developed the first practical algorithm. And we did also some work on complexity, but let me just skip that part. Okay, so now, let me move on to explain what we've been doing afterwards. Okay. So in the next 5 or 6 years, we have been trying to expand applications of horse model checking, and also been trying to make actual tools based on the theory. So in particular, we have implemented automated program verification tool Mochi, which I have demonstrated at the beginning. And initially, Mochi dealt with only safety properties, but after that, we have extended that to also deal with termination and other temporal properties. And we have also considered some fancy application of horse model checking to data compression, but I'll skip that part. And also, during the development of tools, more efficient horse model checkers were required. So we have been looking for better horse model checking algorithms. And also, partially motivated to speed up these model checkers, we have also been studying properties on higher order languages as formal languages. Okay. And so here, let me give a few words about this Mochi and OSAT too, okay? So Mochi is based on a combination of horse model checking and predicate abstraction and SIGAR found in other work on model checking. Okay? So in a sense, Mochi can be considered a higher order counterpart of other model checkers, software model checkers like SLAM and BLAST, developed at Microsoft Research and UC Berkeley. So they were based on pushdown and finite state model checking. And as I said, this horse model checking is consider the generalization of this model checking. So in that sense, our mochi can be considered a higher order counterpart of these systems. So it supports higher order functions and recursion, of course, thanks to the power of host model checking. And we support integers by using predicate abstraction techniques. And we can also support exceptions, again, thanks to the power of host model checking. So since we can freely use high order functions, we can just encode exceptions by using a sort of CPS transformation. And we can actually also encode algebraic data, some of algebraic data types. Okay. For example, a list can be implemented as a pair consisting of an integer that represents the length of the list and a function that returns each element of the list. Okay. So then list primitives can be defined like this, just as a functions on integers. Okay. So let me also give a few words about HostAt2. So HostAt2 is a kind of state-of-the-art host model checker. So it now scales up to tens of or hundreds of thousands of rules, of course, depending on the input. And this is also based on type theoretic foundations, but uses a bit different algorithm, which is a combination of a saturation-based algorithm we proposed and some idea of preface, which has been developed in Ong's group in Oxford. Okay, so let me check. Okay, so now let me explain what we have been doing in the last few years. Okay, so in the last few years, we have been shifting our focus from this host model checking to HFL model checking. Okay. So in HFL model checking, the logic has been extended to high order one called high order fixed point logic. Okay. So let me introduce that one. So HFL is a high order extension of the modal mu calculus. And this actually shows the syntax of modal mu calculus. So in addition to ordinary logical connectives, we have modal operators. Okay? So box A phi means that phi must hold after any A transitions. And diamond A phi means that phi may hold after some A transition. Okay? And we also have fixed point operators to express properties on infinite transition sequences. And in HFL, these fixed point operators are extended to work on higher order predicates. Okay? And to manipulate higher order predicates, we have also lambda abstractions and applications. Okay? And in order to ensure that these fixed points are always well defined, we restrict the shape of formulas by using types. Okay? So this is a type of propositions, and this is type of predicate. And we use typing rules to restrict the shape of formulas. So for example, this rule says that in order for box A phi to be well formed, okay, then phi must be a proposition. And in that case, box A phi is also a proposition. And this rule says that in order for this fixed point formula to be well formed, both fixed point variable x and the body phi must have the same type. Okay. So here's an example of HFL formula. So can you guess what this means? Anyone? No? Okay, so to see what this means, let us unfold this fixed point formula once, okay? Okay, so then we have beta reduction, so a beta redex. Lambda is applied to something, okay? So let us beta reduce it. And then we get this one, okay? So now, can you guess it? No? So by repeating this unfolding of fixed point formulas followed by beta reductions, we get this kind of formula. Okay. So this means that there exists some n such that p holds after n consecutive A transitions and q holds after the same number of B transitions. So this kind of property can't be expressed in the modal mechanics. So HFL is strictly more powerful than, strictly more expressive than the modal mechanics. Okay. And HFL, yeah?
Okay, logic is positive, so there's no negation.
Yeah, actually, so as in the modal mechanics, so we can allow negations, but only in a restricted position. So in the fixed point formula, we only allow variable, fixed point variables to occur in positive positions. Okay. So we can explicitly allow that, but actually with that restriction, we can eliminate negations for closed formulas. So here, for the sake of simplicity, we just represent a normal form without negation. So you can certainly use negations, but only in a restricted way. Is there any question? Fine. Okay. So what was? Okay. So HFL model checking is actually just a finite state model checking problem, and just that the property is expressed by a more expressive logic HFL than usual. Okay. And this problem is also decidable, and just like force model checking, it is kx time complete for order k HFL. Okay. So what we've been doing about this is as follows. So we first, so these are rather different notions of high order model checking. Okay. So here models are extended to high order ones, and here the logic has been extended to high order. But we have shown that there's actually cross correspondence between them, and there are polynomial time mutual translations between both those problems. And we have also shown that there's a direct reduction from program verification problems to HFL model checking, and rather more naturally than reduction to host model checking. So let me explain this part. Okay. So earlier in the talk, I have shown the translations from program verification problems to host model checking. Okay. And this was sort of natural because so there I have translated high order programs to high order recursion schemes. And this is natural because this itself is a kind of high order functional programs. But the question is, so now we want to reduce this to HFL model checking. Okay. So then a naive approach would be to translate high order programs to finite state systems. But that is not a good idea because high order programs have infinite states. Okay. So if we translate it to finite state systems, we will lose some information. Okay. So instead, we translate high order programs to formulas. Okay? And then we translate properties to transition systems. So we switch the roles of systems and properties. Okay? And this formula is a sort of characteristic formula that says that the original program conforms to the specification expressed by this finite state transition system. So let me give you a concrete example. Okay? So this is a contrived version of file accessing program that I've used for the discussion of host model checking. Right? So here now there's no recursion. Okay? And we want to check whether this accesses the file according to read-only file. Okay? So now we want to reduce this to HFL model checking problem. And as I said, I map this property to a transition system that specifies a valid file access protocol. Okay? And then we want to translate this program to a formula that says that this program accesses a file according to this valid access protocol. Okay? So can you guess what formula represents it? No one? So here's the answer. Okay. So since the program first performs read access, we just need to say that read is allowed in the current state. Okay? And the program closes the file after that, so we just need to say that the close is allowed after read. Okay? And then the program terminates, so we say that the program is now allowed to terminate. So basically, whenever a program performs some access, we replace it with a modal operator that says that access is allowed in the current state. Okay? So then this program verification problem is reduced to this HFL model checking problem. Okay. So now let us consider a little more complicated example. So here now we have non-deterministic choice. So then we need to say, so since we don't know whether then branch or else branch is executed, we need to say that both branches are fine, okay? And this formula says that the then branch is okay, right? And this branch says that else branch is okay. Okay? So we just need to combine them with logical conjunction, right? Because we need to say both branches are fine, okay? So now let us consider program involving recursion. So this is actually exactly the same as the example I've used for the discussion of host model checking, okay? So for the combination of reduction, let me slightly modify a bit this in a contention passing style. So now the reduction is actually obvious. So that's it. So we just need to replace each close read operation with a corresponding modal operator. And that's it. And a nice point about this approach is that since HFL is a logic, we can freely extend the logic with data like integers or lists or trees to deal with infinite data programs like this. So now this program uses integer values. Okay? And then this can be mapped to HFL formula of HFL extended with integers like this. So these conditions captures this conditional condition. So this conditional branch. So this approach turned out to provide a more streamlined approach to program verification than a host model checking based approach. So here's an image of the host and HFL based approach. So in host based approach, we have to deal with various kinds of program properties. We have devised different kinds of program transformations and combined, mixed them to solve, finally reduce it to host model checking problem. So it is a kind of messy, but in HFL model checking, we can uniformly reduce verification problem, various verification problems to HFL model checking problems. So that has a great advantage. And another nice point is that this can be also considered a natural extension of other recent approaches to program verification, and most notably approach based on constrained home clauses. So based on this, so model checkers like C-Horum and J-Horum have been developed recently. So this HFL can be considered an extension of CHC with high-order predicates and fixed-point alternations. And we have been doing also some work to improve the scalability of Mochi, but I'll skip that part. Okay. So what are we doing now? So given the advantage of HFL-based approach, we are now trying to rebuild our tools based on the new HFL-based approach. So we have so far implemented pure HFL model checker and also the validity checker for first order fragment of HFL extended with integers. And that is going to be presented at SAS this week. And in theory, we are currently interested in average case complexity of high order model checking to answer why high order model checking works at all despite extremely high worst case complexity. And also, we have recently worked on the probabilistic extensions of host model checking, but I don't have time to discuss it. Okay, so here's a conclusion. So I summarized what we've been doing on high-order model checking. And I'd say that there are still a lot of remaining challenges. So from practical aspect, more tool constructions are required to make a real impact in practice. And in theory, there are still a lot of open problems about it. So I hope some of you get interested in this field and contribute to the progress of this field. Okay. Thanks for your attention.